The Lord has much to reveal to you about himself and what he is doing with his creation, especially through you, his bride, the church. As he reveals this to us, as he reveals himself and his great works, the only proper response is really worship. And this can take the form of faith and hope and love. So let's enter into that now as we worship our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we're gonna begin our service by calling upon him or invoking his name in prayer. So please join me. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for gathering us here. We ask, Lord, that through this liturgy, through the words, through the songs, through every part, that you would use these things to mature us as your people, to bind us together in faith and hope and love, united by the Spirit with Christ. We ask, Lord God, that in this maturity we would sing forth your praises, that, Lord, you would hear our song as a victory chant of what you are doing inevitably with your creation, bringing all things to your glory, ordering all things as you have always intended under the kingship of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, you are the King and head of your church, and we pray that you would rule over us now. We ask for your Spirit, that we may worship you in the Spirit and in truth. We pray, Lord, that we would not leave here the same, but that we would be changed because we are not just hearers of your word, but we are doers. We ask these things in your name. Amen. 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 Let's stand for our call to worship from Psalm 146. And you all can funnel on in and find a seat. Psalm 146, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son of man in whom there is no help. His spirit departs, he returns to his earth. In that very day, his plans perish. Happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps truth forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives freedom to the prisoners. Amen. Let's praise this God who has just declared by singing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Amen. Let us now behold our Christ from Ephesians 2:19 through 22. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Behold your Christ and his work. Amen. Let us pray. Oh, Lord Christ, we thank you for this revelation of yourself and the great work that you are doing by the sending of your Spirit. We thank you, O Spirit, that you execute the great decrees, bringing what is decreed in heaven to be actual and visible here on earth. We ask, Lord Christ, that in fact by your Spirit, you would bring your will to earth as it is on heaven in our very hearts. We have contributed to the darkness this past week, and yet you have called us to be light. We ask therefore that you'd work through the means of our elder this morning, calling us to you, that we might be your loyal followers by the grace of the Spirit and for your glory. Amen. 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 You may be seated.
Good morning. I'm ruling elder Chase Vaughn, standing in for Jeremiah this morning. For this morning's confession, I would like for us to focus in on the 10th commandment. The 10th commandment, taken from Exodus 20, verse 17, says, "You shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is thy neighbor's." Like many of the other commandments, our catechisms expound each commandment by looking at positive duties required by the commandment, as well as sins that are forbidden. So I'd like to take a moment and look at question 147 and 148. What are the duties required in the 10th commandment? The duties required in the 10th commandment are such a full contentment with our own condition and such a charitable frame of the whole soul toward our neighbor as that all our inward motions and affections touching him tend unto and further all that is good, all that good which is his. So notice at the heart of that positive duty is a full contentment with our own station and a love of our neighbor's good. Question 148 from the larger catechism. If I can find it in my notes. I left that one out, so we'll just stick with 147. I do have some scripture. The catechism for question 147 gives us a couple texts to look at. So 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 10, the Apostle Paul speaks about contentment. He says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs." So notice the limitation that the apostle places on our desires. We are to be satisfied with food and clothing, which I take to be the necessities of life. When we begin to desire more than what is necessary, we fall into temptation, into harmful desires, and eventually these lead to destruction. Another passage is Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. the writer to the Hebrews says, keep your life free from love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Notice here in this passage, the root of covetous desire. It is the lack of trust in the Lord and in his loving provision of all that we need. When we trust in the Lord, we are content. When we fail to trust, we begin to strive for worldly possessions. As we enter into a time of prayer, I'd like for you to ask yourself, what do your desires look like throughout this past week? What are they oriented to? Are they oriented to God and his care for us? Or are your desires for worldly things accumulating more and more, things that you cannot take with you at death? During confession, I will pray a corporate prayer of confession and then provide a time of silence for you. Let us pray together. O Lord, our God, you have promised us that you will never leave us nor forsake us. We can confidently say, you, Lord, are our helper. We will not fear. What can man do to us? Lord, as your people, we will fear neither sickness nor poverty nor the loss of a loved one, for not even a hair can fall from our heads without you willing it to be so. And so you have commanded us to be content with what we have, not to desire more than what is necessary for life. We brought nothing into this world, and we cannot take anything with us out of the world. But Lord, we confess now before you that we often feel dissatisfied with our present situations. We often compare our lives to others. We envy, we covet the seemingly perfect lives of our brothers and sisters. We think that if only we had what others enjoy, we would then be happy and satisfied. If only we had good health. If only we had a wife or husband. If only my spouse was more like their spouse. If only a bigger house, a newer car, more and more. Lord, help us to recognize the danger of these covetous desires, that such desires lead away from trusting in you. Help us, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, to put to death these desires, to live modestly and with contentment. Help us to find our only satisfaction and happiness in seeking first your kingdom and your righteousness and trusting you for all that we need. Father, we thank you for the many graces that you have given us in your word, the grace of your warnings that some of our desires will lead to our harm and to our eternal destruction. We thank you that you warn us about those dangers, to encourage us to love you with all our heart, to love our neighbor as ourselves. We thank you also for the grace of the promises we have in Christ Jesus, that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Please lift your eyes and hear this assurance of pardon taken from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 18. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were afar off and to those who were near. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Amen. Please stand with me. Let's sing in response hymn number 2. Come, ye sinners, poor and needy.
Thank you.
Let us sing the doxology as the usher comes forward with the tithes and offerings. Father, we bring to you the surplus of what you have given to us. You have blessed us in so many ways. And Lord, out of love for you, a love for our neighbor, we give these tithes back to you. We ask, Lord, that you would bless this money to the service of your kingdom, to those in need in our community, or in our county, but ultimately unto that end that all things would glorify you, that all people would bow the knee to our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Please remain standing for the reading of God's word, and children 3 and younger are now dismissed to the nursery.
Let's open our scriptures together to Judges chapter 16, 20, and we'll begin reading in 23. We'll finish out the Samson episode this morning. Beginning in verse 23 of chapter 16. Now the lords of the Philistines gathered together to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to rejoice. And they said, "Our God has delivered into our hands Samson, our enemy." When the people saw him, they praised their god, for they said, "Our God has delivered into our hands our enemy, the destroyer of our land, and the one who multiplied our dead." So it happened, when their hearts were merry, that they said, "Call for Samson, that he may perform for us." So they called for Samson from the prison, and he performed for them. And they stationed him between the pillars. Then Samson said to the lad who held him by the hand, "Let me feel the pillars which support the temple, so that I can lean on them." Now the temple was full of men and women. All the lords of the Philistines were there, about 3,000 men and women on the roof, while watching Samson performed. Then Samson called to the Lord, saying, "O Lord God, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray, just this once, O God, that I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes." And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars which supported the temple, and he braced himself against them, one on his right and the other on his left. Then Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." Then he pushed with all his might, and the temple fell on the lords and all the people who were in it. So the dead that he killed at his death were more than he had killed in his life. And his brothers and all his father's household came down and took him and brought him up and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the tomb of his father Manoah. He had judged Israel 20 years. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we pray that we would learn your heavenly lessons this morning We pray that you would make us good students in the school of Christ. We ask this in his name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, briefly, last week, we acknowledged that when the church is canonized, it is shaved of its strength. But guess what? Hair grows back. Now, I hope that you all, I didn't get a chance to dwell on that part of the proposition or doctrine last week, but I hope that that goes deep into your soul nevertheless. There's plenty of things in the world to discourage you, and I just want you to remember, hair grows back. And that's what we were dwelling on last week. Now, we have a few observations this week with the final episode of Samson's account, and then we'll move into some more horrific scenes. So let's begin by just noticing a few things together, and then I have two main applications. The first thing I want you to notice is that just like we're really continuing from last week, Samson was in prison, as we saw with those dramatic reversals. And this week, we can see the scene moves quickly away from him in prison. It's going to move back to him as he's brought onto the scene. But it moves away from him for us to see the Philistines exulting in his capture by singing hymns to their God. You can see that in verses 23 and 24. At first, it is the leaders of the Philistines in verse 23. The title given here are lords. You think of a city, and each mayor of a city is now gathered to celebrate this thing. You could think of it that way. That's in verse 23, and they sing a little hymn or make a poem for him. And then it's the same thing with the larger group of people or the people of the Philistines in 24. They have a little victory chant themselves. And what's interesting about the chant, which is always good for us to see in our primarily secular culture, is that the Philistines theologically interpret what is going on with the capture of Samson. In other words, they have here not attributed the capture of Samson to their own strength, but to the patronage of their God, who is Dagon. He is the one who always provides for them. They just had to be patient, and here he is acting on their behalf, so says the Philistines, and so they sing him two victory hymns. You can see that in the stanzas. I hope it's in poetic verse in your Bibles. That's the first, that's the kickoff here with this beginning of this last episode of Samson. We then move into a second notification or observation. The songs were part of a larger victory party. You can see this in verse 25. Hey, we're singing. Somebody get the champagne and the cigars. Let's turn this into a bigger party bash. That's essentially what they do. The wine is spilling, and they need some entertainment to go along with it. So someone comes up with the bright idea to bring Samson out. I think it was the lad. You remember hearing about the lad in the story? I think it's the lad who brought him up out of the prison. They bring him up out of the prison. They place him in the center of a room between two pillars. So if you want to picture this, imagine that there is a balcony going all the way around this room, and it's large enough to fill up with several thousand people, and they're all looking down in the center, and in the center are two pillars holding up the whole thing, the whole structure, and in the center of those pillars is the one that they have conquered. And he is there now, in his humiliation, a form of amusement for those who are drinking the champagne and smoking the cigars. It would be quite similar to what you will see within the Roman era when they conquer Christians. They dip them in lighter fluid, tie them to a stake, and make them garden torches as they enjoy their hors d'oeuvres walking around the garden. You can read about that or ask any history teacher about the reign of Nero and Diocletian. Well, it's something similar here, and now you get the suspense and you get the picture of what is getting ready to happen at this party. And that takes us to the observation number three. The way the narrator unfolds this, you really should be feeling the tension. Wait a second, the strongest man, stronger than lions, is between two pillars holding up an entire structure, and everybody's on the second floor? And hair grows back? Oh, Guess what's going to happen? Dun, dun, dun. I was almost tempted while reading the scripture to say, dun, dun, dun. Well, here it is. And this is magnificent, actually. There's a moment of lucidity and clarity for Samson. The moment goes away rather quickly, in my opinion. But there is a moment because he prays, and the words here are Adonai Yahweh. He, for the first time, is not saying Elohim, which is the same word that is used by the Philistines to talk about a deity in general. Here he says Adonai Yahweh, which is to say sovereign Lord. And with one, he asks for one last burst of strength decreed by the sovereignty of God. And that was his moment of clarity, and now it will go away because he will not use his strength for the benefit of the community. He simply wants personal vengeance because the gouged out his eyes. So he wants one blow for the two eyes. And that was meant to be put poetically, the way that he framed that. Samson therefore braces, it says in some translation, it gets the idea like he's holding onto it. He's not. It's like this. That's the picture. He's pushing out the pillars. Samson braces the left arm and the right arm, and he pushes and he says, "Let me die with the Philistines." And with that, the whole temple comes crashing down, all of the people and the lords of the Philistines, and the narrator poetically ends the scene with this beautiful little statement, and he says, "So the dead that he killed at his death were more than he had killed in his life." Beautiful little statement to summarize the life of Gideon and to see his end. Now, this is pretty interesting, but I found out this week, it's always interesting to see how have these stories been read by the faithful throughout the centuries. And actually, John Milton has picked up this story, and he's written his own account or lyrical poem about Samson. Perhaps you want to read that. But John Milton has in his poem, "Samson emerging from his blindness and powerlessness, enriched and ennobled, sacrificing his life for the sake of God's divine mission." That's how he views this moment. And I would like to talk to John and just say, what are you reading? Because it doesn't seem to be the same thing that I'm reading. Enriched and ennobled to sacrifice himself for the divine mission? Now, I do think that God is, he's always gracious. And I think he is gracious here, and he does honor the one whom he called, who is Samson, by giving him this at the end, rather than him just dying there, chained to two pillars while everybody's laughing at him. In a sense, he gets the last laugh. And I do think in that way, he is honored. But that is not what is going on here with this account. Paying attention, though God gives some honor to Samson, even at the hour of his death, Samson only thinks of himself. Think about what the narrator is doing here and how the Spirit orders all of these things. Samson was called to deliver God's people from the oppression of the Philistines, and instead of using his strength for that, he squandered it, chasing only those things that were for his personal pleasure, which is why his eyes are continually brought up. He's just an impulsive person, only chasing what his eyes see. And even at the end, when he has no eyes, he's still fighting for his eyes in some way. He can't get out of his own way. The divine mission is not his motive, though God is gracious and did honor him at the end to where he would get the last laugh. "Let me take vengeance for my two eyes." And that's the key here. Because what we end up seeing with Samson when he cries, "Let me die with the Philistines," is that's about right. He's very much a Philistine. And the way that he conducts himself and the way that he thinks about his life, and particularly how he treats women, which will launch us into the next couple episodes in Judges. Samson lives by bodily impulse and personal vendetta. And in the end, Samson, who acts like a Philistine, dies with the rest of the Philistines. Yet in the midst of this, and this is always the other side of the coin within Judges, Adonai Yahweh accomplishes his plan to deal a strategic death blow to the Philistine nation. Not only the people were present there in the temple to Dagon, but the lords, the mayors, those in charge, those seeking to make all of the decisions, the generals, the lords of each city of the Philistines are killed in a single blow, giving a strategic advantage to Israel. And so what we saw in the beginning of Samson's account in verse 4 has certainly been accomplished by Yahweh despite Samson himself. And we end his story. Now, when we gather all of these things up, like ingredients to bake a cake, the doctrinal cake that you have this morning that we're to eat from is this. Another symptom of the canonization of the church is this. When we often substitute the divine mission for our personal ambitions. Now that is a trajectory that the church goes on, is really all I'm saying to you, and we're supposed to learn from that. The church, throughout history, can be tempted to substitute the divine mission for personal ambitions. There's another way to say this, and it's this. We can be a people that move from thy kingdom come to my kingdom come. Thy kingdom come to my kingdom come. Now, we're all aware of that reality. But that's our doctrine this morning. What I would like to do is look at that doctrine under two main headings, the mirror of God and the mission of God. And I have been praying for you all morning. Been praying for you all morning that I and you would be good soil for the seed of the word, and that we would grow up and have a harvest that brings fruit into this world. That's what we need. So may God use these points to that end. We often say, move from saying, thy kingdom come to my kingdom come. So the mirror of God is where I'd like to begin. That's the first point. Now, if you wanted to, you could flip a couple pages and you can see that our Judges series is getting ready to end here pretty soon. So I better come up with what we're going to do next. And since we are at the end of the Judges series, I therefore hope that you have, by way of the Spirit, become attuned to the fact that Judges is very much acting like the mirror that James talks about inside of his book, inside of his letter. James says, when you look into the Word, it's like a mirror, and the Scriptures show you yourself, and they show you the church, so that you then can perfect what is lacking by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the first two chapters of James. You're welcome. That's what he's teaching, and Judges, in this case, is the mirror, and it's revealing so much to us about what can happen in the church over time, and I think that the Spirit is allowing you to see the truth of these statements and to connect to them and to change. When we look into Judges, we see the ways and the symptoms of worldliness within the church. And like I said last week, let us not turn from the mirror of His Word, forgetting what we've heard about the worldliness, running off into worldliness, but let us fill up what is lacking. Let us be not just hearers, but doers of the Word. Now that's all I have for that first point. That's the mirror of God. I just want to orient you as to how you should be viewing this account of Samson. I want you to look into the mirror, and I want you not only to see Samson, I want you to see yourself and the church. What are the lessons that we are to learn from looking into that mirror? What does Christ want you to see and to remember and to change? That is the framework of the mirror. Now, the second application point, which will take up the whole rest of the time, is the mission of God. So now that we know we have a mirror of God, there is a mission of God. When we think of our passage this morning from the framework of the mirror of James, what do you see? You will see more than what I can tell you up here. There's not enough time. What do you see? What does Samson show us about ourselves? He shows us, at the least, that although God gives us a divine mission or commission, we often neglect that commission for other endeavors. Now, in Samson's case, it was this set of things called his personal pleasures. But it could be 10,000 other things that pull you off the path of the commission or the divine mission. He shows us that although God gives us a divine mission, we neglect that mission for other endeavors. Samson neglected his mission for personal lust and materialism. Surely there's 1,000 other ways to neglect the divine mission. And this is where I really want to dig in this morning for us. When we look into the mirror, wherein are we neglecting our great commission that Jesus Christ has given to us? The saints have always divided the Great Commission into two main parts. I wonder if you know what those are. If you know the confession, then you know those two parts of the Great Commission. It's always this: gathering and perfecting. That is the great vocation and job of the church, to gather those whom Christ is calling from the world, bringing them from darkness into light, and then helping them to perfect or mature and develop in the image of Christ. That is the vocation of the church. God the Father has given all authority in heaven and earth to His Son, Jesus the Christ. The authorized Jesus sends out His church to gather in disciples from the world into the church, or the household of the living God. Then, once they are under Christ's roof, so to speak, the saints are to teach them and each other to obey everything which King Jesus commands. We, consequently, as a new group of people, peculiar people, followers of Jesus, we become a separate people in the world, giving witness to the good news that God has made Jesus the Christ of the cosmos. And we begin to bring, by His power, to earth now, the kingdom which shall be fully installed later, and that is meant to be good news. Now, when we look in the mirror and we see that part of our mission is to help the saints to mature, it seems that we are not just hearers of the word, but we are in fact doers of the word. In other words, think about our management of the household of God. You could easily look around and you could see, I know this is not going to happen perfectly, I know that you probably have some complaints with regard to this, but you will see discipleship taking place, saints maturing. You will see it. You will see people helping other saints be loyal followers of Jesus Christ. I see it all the time. But another question has to be raised, and that is, what is Severn Run doing about the first part of the commission, which is the gathering of those from the world, from darkness into light? What are we doing on that part of our job? When we look in the mirror, we are led from Samson's commission to our great commission. We hear that we must seek the lost and then help them mature as followers of Christ, but the question is raised, are we seeking the lost as a congregational effort? Now, when I say seeking the lost, I wonder if you're bothered by it. Because as soon as I say that, I admit that there is a kind of danger or an association that you don't want to make, which is for Severn Run to become a seeker-sensitive church. Now, there's a good way to talk about being sensitive, and there is an appropriate way to talk about seekers. We'd have to have a theological discussion about all that. But I'm talking about the negative association that we make to churches that are considered only seeker-sensitive, and we don't want to be associated with that. And the reason is because what the criticism that seems rightful about becoming a seeker-sensitive church is that you're moving, again, from considering the maturity and helping the saints to be raised up in wisdom, you hardly give any time to that, and you're only seeking the lost, and so you end up having a lot of people that are hardly mature at all. And we see that that's a problem. But both are problems. Not seeking the lost is a problem, and then leaving them immature is a problem. And I don't want to be either of those churches. So if you were to picture a lane on a highway, don't fall off the cliff here, and don't fall off the cliff here. Well, that's very difficult to do, and may Jesus Christ grant us the maturity to stay in the lane. Here, however, at Severn Run, maturity, at the very least, has begun. I am amazed continually at the maturity of this group of Christians. I had a fellow seminarian who is far superior to me in his understanding of theology and all of these other things. He visited from Canada the other week, and he sat here during Sunday school, and he felt so compelled by what was happening around him that at the end of the class, he asked permission to speak, and he just wanted to commend all of the Christians present because they were so mature in their understanding of Christ and his kingdom. And I hear that all the time, and I see how you conduct yourself as mature saints. Have you arrived? No. If you think you have, talk to me. I'll point out some of your flaws. I know them. We have at least begun to become mature, but what about offering the gracious hand of Jesus Christ to the world lost in their sins? If we are in the light, and the hand from the light, full of light, is to enter into the darkness, how many hands from Severn Run are reaching? We sang a song this morning, "Come Ye Sinners," and by God's grace, somebody is here that can hear that and repent onto life. But I'll be honest with you, we're going to have to figure out a way to sing that song someplace else so that people can hear about Christ who actually need to hear about him for the first time, as opposed to just maturing saints. Let me put it this way. The great tragedy with Samson, and that's how we have to see his story, it's a tragic story of the church embodied in a single person through a literary device. The great tragedy with Samson was that he had the strength, but he misused his strength only to secure personal pleasures. And I fear that God's church, not just here but elsewhere, is falling into the same tragedy. And I fear this partially because of my own convictions that are falling over me, where I cannot just keep walking down this path with you. Something has got to change. I do not want to suffer the same tragic fate as Samson. And I know that you don't either. I want you to think about just for a moment the strength which the Lord has given to us. And if I could bring other communities in here that I've been exposed to, our strength would be that much more emphasized in comparison. You would see the gifts that He has given to us. They are enormous. Look at the knowledge that you have. Look at the resources that you have. Look at the education that you have that has given you, that theological education, and whatever else education there is. Look at the finances that you have. Look at the wisdom that you have to work through situations. You're not stumbling through life. You're walking as the wise. You're being successful in most of the endeavors that you set your heart and mind to, because of the grace that Christ has given to you. Look at the property that we have, mortgage-free. When we go to our congregational meeting, look at the overabundance of giving that has been happening within the church. We are going to have to change by a huge tier our budgetary expectations because there's so much coming in. Look at how much money is in the deacons' fund to be able to help people. Look at the good health that this congregation is blessed with. These are all strengths that Jesus Christ gives to us. For what? That's the question that has to arise within our minds. That's the one that the devil does not want you to ask. And if you start to ask it, he wants you to stop thinking about it and just watch something on Netflix. And the question is this: what does God want you to do with the strength that he gives to you? Why has he made you strong? Is it not analogous to why he made Samson strong? And what happens when we waste our strength, but we suffer the same fate as Samson? Does he not want us to get to use some of it to gather those whom the Lord is calling and not all of it on ourselves in our maturity? Surely that is the case. And that's probably a false dilemma, because if we found ourselves going to reach the lost, he'd probably double our strength and there'd be no loss. Does Jesus not want us to bring his light to the dark spaces? Some of you say, no, he wants us to hate these people because of what they are doing to our world. Without denying the evil, I challenge you, brothers and sisters, because Jesus Christ has not arrived to exact his vengeance on these people yet, which tells me that now is not the time for anger or vengeance. Now is the time to act in his patience, and his patience is always for the sake of giving more time for repentance, that more may enter into his kingdom who he has called. So you have your timing off. If you think now is the time of vengeance to just hate everybody around you and be skeptical and cynical, you're off your time. Your calendar is wrong. Jesus wants us to bring his light to the dark spaces. Now, I want to share with you an experience that I recently had with Holly. Some of you know about this experience, but I want to share it with all of you. It has become a great sign in my life from God's providence. How many of you here know Greg Shade? I'm seeing some. Yeah, Greg Shade is a local Youth for Christ leader. And I hope that you get a chance to meet him. He visits here in the morning, sometimes in the evening. Greg, are you here, by the way? I'm getting ready to talk about you. No, he's not. Okay. Very good. He invited Holly and us to attend a group. And in this group, he seeks to give the gospel to unchurched students from three critical areas: Brooklyn Park, Pasadena, or the Dina, as they would say, and Severn. Unchurched kids. They're not in homes where the church is a thing. He meets with them. Now, Greg gave me time. Holly and I both went. We sat around a bonfire. Greg gave me time to share my difficult past and how Jesus Christ has changed everything. And that was such a privilege that was given to where I could speak to that. And we prayed. I knew that I had been in their shoes before, and if some fat 45-year-old showed up to talk to me about his life, I would not be interested. But by God's grace, they were a captive audience. After my story, and they were locked onto the whole story, which was amazing to me. I was praying and thanking God even while I was speaking because they were so attentive. After my story, the students asked me one question after another, all related to their own miseries and all their own confusions. And I'm not going to violate their trust and share with you what they asked me about. But I'm telling you right now, you would have left that bonfire, you would have gone into your car, and you would have cried. You would have been that overwhelmed by the situations that those 14 through 18-year-olds are facing. Now, I finally got through, I don't know, the 50 questions. I mean, Holly will be like, no, it was 35 and a half. It felt like 50 questions, babe. It were a lot of questions. And at the very end, Greg wanted to wrap the whole thing up, and he asked me to share my favorite Bible verse, which, by the way, I hate that question because I love the whole Bible. But then there sprung to mind a Bible verse that we talked about a couple weeks ago, Isaiah 49. You remember that? So it sprung to mind. I was like, wait a second. I do have a favorite Bible verse. But it's from Isaiah. And then Greg says to all the kids, because they have no idea what Isaiah is, it's in the Old Testament, guys. He's a pastor. So I say Isaiah 49. And I start and I say, I cannot tell you verse by verse or word by word an exact representation of what it is in the Scripture. So I'm going to paraphrase it for you. And I said, there is a group of people that raise a question and they say, God, why have you abandoned us? And I looked down across the bonfire and there was a girl and I saw it connected. And she was saying inside her head, because I have preacher eyes and I can see what you're saying in your head. And she said inside her head, it's exactly right. Why has God abandoned me? And then, as they were all still sitting there, I said, as a means of argument to show that God has not abandoned, he raises this question. Can a woman forget her nursing child? I said it this way. Can a mother forget her child? And you ask Holly this. I think it seemed, at least, I didn't count, but it seemed like every single kid around the bonfire said, yes, our mothers will leave us, because they already did. Some of them didn't know where their mother was that week. And this is where the preaching started. Because by the grace of Jesus Christ, what rose up in me was I was able to say to them, that's the right answer. God says the same thing. God says, yes, even some of your mothers will leave you, but guess what? Which is the next verse in Isaiah 49. I will never leave you. I found myself standing all of a sudden before the bonfire with all those kids, and I was preaching the gospel. Now, there's three things that I want you to take from that story, that I am taking from the story. First, the misery and confusion of those outside of Christ is truly a darkness, and they need the light and love of Jesus Christ through you at this time more than ever. I just want to ask you a simple question that doesn't even involve you yet. What kind of man would I be if I saw that and I do nothing about it? What kind of man would I be? There is misery and confusion out there, and they need the light of Jesus Christ. Number two, the reason, and this is key, because if you think that you're just going to show up at Watt Chapel and start preaching the Bible and then everyone's going to fall at your feet, that's not the picture. The reason, this is number two, the reason why those students were present to hear the word preached was because Greg Shade has for decades given up his life for these kids. He has given up his life, folks. That's not an exaggeration. He has poured himself into them. And that is why they were there. It was, the preaching could happen because of all of the plow work that Greg had done over the years. He had his hand on the plow. And that's a lesson we need to take if you think this is going to be easy. And here's number three, and this is very important for you to hear. Because I see your souls. As I preach the word by the power of Jesus Christ, I watch the seed of the word go into the soil of their souls. It didn't bounce back at me. Now, I've seen that. Sometimes the words I say up here, you're bouncing back at me, not taking any of them. But with these children, these teenagers, it didn't bounce back. Now, that's really interesting. It didn't bounce back. It went into the soil. I don't know what will happen. I don't know how quickly it will grow or what it will grow into, but it was mystifying for me to see that. And what this should do for you is this should begin to quench your cynicism and let you know that Jesus Christ has not given up on the people that are around you, even in our own communities. You, my friends, are afraid to walk in Brooklyn Park at night. But I'm telling you the truth that it seems to me that Jesus Christ is already up there walking night or day. And the question is do you want to join him? That's the work that he's doing on the second part of the first part of the commission. And that all tie into some experiences that not only I have, but you have. In line with that thought that we need to start dropping our skepticism, drop the cynicism, realize that Jesus Christ is still doing, he's still pulling people out of the world into his church, even in this county. In line with that thought, Christ has given this congregation several new believers and their baptisms for this church to see that we should not lose our hope to gather in a new harvest from our surrounding area. And I met with two more people this week who will be making, Lord willing, a profession of faith before you soon for the first time. I am just about to the point to say, the harvest is ripe. Where are the field workers? The most important question before you this morning is, will you take the divine mission seriously, or will you be distracted from your mission just like Samson was? Full of strength, but utterly useless. Now, I want to say something about that, and then we're going to close. I want you to listen. Most of you, when I say, are you going to do this good work, which is part of the Great Commission? Or are you going to be distracted? I just want to remind you of what we said last week, that those distractions are going to catch you off guard, because these distractions are not evil, they are indifferent and good. The distractions will be all of these kinds of things: recreational sports, school clubs, vacations, dinners and lunches with our friends, boating, youth groups, and even Bible studies, which are all good things. They all should have a place within our life, or could have a place. They are a choice that we can make, but they can become so prioritized and so mislocated that we have no time to do our actual job. If you were sitting at work, and your boss came to you and saw that you played Minecraft all day long, and you're not a Minecraft video game designer, then you have a problem. All of those good things can be good in their proper place. But what, here's the main question where Satan keeps getting us. But what happens when those same things displace the timely good of gathering the lost? And the question raises up again. Who among you are going to be the real reformers? Or will you be the church canonized? Because you chose, instead of following the Great Commission, instead to prioritize what Americans prioritize. That's the question. Who is going to be the rebel? Who is going to bring the kingdom of Christ? Who will stop displacing the timely good and instead seek to gather the lost? Our doctrine this morning is that another symptom of the canonization of the church is when we substitute the divine mission for our personal ambitions, and we could add our amusements. We move from saying, thy kingdom come, to my kingdom come. And that's a matter of priorities. May we not only be hearers, but doers of the word. May we not only perfect the saints, but seek to gather the lost from darkness into light. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the King and head of your church, and you speak to your church through the preaching of the word. And though you have matured us, Lord, there is a maturity that is yet to be seen, at least collectively as a people, and it is a zealous concern for those who are lost. I pray, Lord Jesus Christ, that you would give the illumination of your Holy Spirit and the will to all of us to make your agenda and kingdom and your priorities our priorities. I pray, Lord Jesus Christ, that we would not be another generation that is Americanized in how we spend our time and what is important to us. I thank you so much for the witness that you have given to us in Greg Shade and how he has given up his life and that there is fruit from it. I pray, Lord Jesus Christ, that you would help us to imitate him as he imitates you. I pray, Lord, that you would show us the way forward on these things. Even if it's small, just show us the path, give us the courage. Lord, I pray that you would light a fire in the hearts of at least some people here and that they would become pushy about the Great Commission. I pray that they would become relentless. I pray that they would insist in getting a hearing. I ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and respond to the preached word by singing Jesus Paid It All. And I ask for the elders to please prepare the table. Amen. You may be seated. Let us give thanks for this table. Oh, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for sending your only begotten Son. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for voluntarily taking upon yourself human nature, to do the great work of redemption for the health of your church and the glory of the Godhead. We thank you, Christ, for sending your Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for working your will within us. Amen. This is the table of the Lord Jesus Christ, the same one who sends us out into the world. He has come into the world first to save sinners. Even while we were sinners and not calling upon his name, wanting nothing to do with him, he came to our neighborhoods. And he has given us this table so that we are not like orphans. He wants us to know that we're still connected to him. We still commune with him. He still strengthens us. He sees everything that's going on, and he keeps all of his promises. He's not like some of those mothers that those children had. Jesus Christ gives this as a table for his the strength of his church, and it is not a table in general from which anyone can eat. In fact, I would say that even if you are not a Christian here this morning, that in a way this table is a grace to you also. By the fact that I'm going to let you know that you can't eat of this meal with us, it lets you know that you're on the outside of something. And you being excluded on the outside of that thing is very serious. It's the worst place that you've ever been in your whole life. And I would encourage you, instead of remaining outside of this meal, to run to Christ and find out all about him and what this meal means. What is the gospel and all the work that is behind it? What happened in the past and how does that make a difference for the present? What will happen in the future? Where is this whole world going? To whom can you turn for help? How do you know what to do in terms of right or wrong or the situations that you face? Those are the kind of questions that I encourage you to bring to these brothers that are up here or a Christian that you respect. And perhaps, even while you see the plate pass you by, or the bread pass you by, perhaps you could pray to God, even for the first time, and ask him to please reveal himself to you. You could even say what Samson said. You could say, Adonai Yahweh, if you wanted to be fancy. You could say, Sovereign Lord, please reveal yourself to me. There are warnings that are given to us in the Scriptures about who should partake of this supper and not. And it's from 1 Corinthians 11:27 and following. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many die. If you are not a Christian, ask those questions. Say that prayer if you're up for it. But let this go by, because this meal is not for you unless you're making a profession of loyalty and faith to Christ. For those of you who are Christians, this table is for you. I don't know about all of you. I don't know about all your secrets. That's because they're secret. But I wonder what you would be like if Jesus Christ never came and grabbed you. And Jesus didn't float down from heaven and grab you. He sent you a preacher of some sort. And I wonder if when we look at the work that Jesus Christ has done by coming into the world and his body being broken for those who are sinners in sinful neighborhoods, I wonder if this could motivate us too as to what our mission is, and that we will be his mouth and his hands and his feet, that this world may see the good news which he offers. And I wonder, secondly, if as you partake of his table, and you remember the good news again for you, if that grace could so fill your soul that you can't hold on to it, you have got to tell other people about the good news. That what Christ has given to you, you must give to others. I'd encourage you to reflect on the meal in that way. Here is Jesus Christ, broken for you as a sinner. Here is his blood of the new covenant, spilled for you as a sinner. Let us pray, and then we'll have a distribution of the elements. Lord, it is quite profound as we think about that we are going to all partake of the one loaf, at least symbolically, and all of the same cup symbolically, which is you. It is a declaration of our unity in you, which certainly pronounces our status as righteous in you, that you have justified us by grace through faith. But Lord, it also says what we are to be like you in the world. I pray that as we take of your supper, that we would remember you in this thick sense. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Brothers, we're going to start with the distribution of the bread. The smaller cup is gluten-free, if that suits you, and we'll take this together as a family. Thank you. For I received from the Lord that which I have delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us take and eat. Lord, this bread, at the very least, symbolizes you and the life, the eternal life that you give to us, and the strength that flows from never-ending streams of your Spirit. O Christ, look of the fitness that you have given to us. But Lord, you have revealed this morning a major atrophy, that though we claim to have communion with you, we yet still lack a heart for the lost, which means that we do not have your heart. Now that is, Lord, to be said in part. We do have your heart. We ask that by this meal and the remembrance of you and what you're doing in this world and for this world, even those who are especially sick with sin and confusion and misery, we pray, Lord, that you would stir us up, that our hearts would grow into your heart. Lord, we are mature by your grace in many ways. Oh, but we lack this. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, pour out your grace on us. Send us. I pray that you would raise up courageous men and women who will say, "Lord, send me." I ask, Lord, that as a result of this, that you would feed those who are in darkness, that they would feed on you by faith as we are doing now, that we would have to have 2 loaves of bread, that you would have to multiply it to 6. O Lord Christ, gather your elect from the world. We ask these things in your name. Amen. The Lord has also given us the cup, which we'll distribute now. The center portion in colored glasses is grape juice. The clear portions are wine. We'll take this together as a family. Thanks, brothers. Thank you. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Let us take and drink. Lord Jesus Christ, the cup that we just took is the cup of the new covenant. The cup of the new covenant is the promise that not only Jew, but every nation shall be afforded the opportunity by your effectual call for repentance and faith unto eternal life. And Lord, you have shown us that you are especially going to those who know that they need a physician. Lord Christ, give us as your congregation discernment. Help us to know when to stop throwing pearls to the rich swine and affluent that are in our lives, and when to spend our time on those that will listen. But we nevertheless pray that whether rich or poor, they would all come to a knowledge of Jesus Christ and salvation in him. Lord, let your streams of mercy be preached forth by the people of Severn Run. Let them show hospitality with wisdom. Lord, let them get to the work of the plow, that the seed might fall on good soil and would grow up to produce a harvest that is full. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and close our service with song. Now receive the Lord's benediction. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. May he make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.